Thank you very much for asking me to talk. And my talk will focus on imaging, the various imaging modalities that we use for looking after our TAVI patients. I'll start talking about the screening imaging, and then go on to the procedure itself, and finish off with the follow-up. Sharon said, TAVI stands, for those of you who don't know, for Transcatheter Aortic Valve Implantation, or if you come from the U.S., Transcatheter Aortic Valve Replacement, or TAVR. Thankfully, we've adopted TAVI as our term. So, okay, there we go. The assessment pre-TAVI, and if we just go back, let me see if I can go back here. So if we go back, there are various imaging modalities that have been used over the years. TAVI has been around for about 12 years now, since the first in man. There's been about 100,000 plus studies performed worldwide, and the annual rate is about 18,000 TAVI procedures per year. Up until recently, there were two valves, the Edwards valve and the Sapien valve, and the Medtronic core valve. And I'll talk a little bit about the different valves later on. More recently, there's been some more valves come onto the Australian market, the Portico valve from St. Jude, and which looks more or less like the Medtronic core valve, and the Boston Lotus valve. And soon we'll get the second version of the Medtronic core valve called the Evolute, and the second or third version of the Sapien valve called the Sapien 3. So there'll be six different valves then. And it is somewhat important when you do the follow-up echo assessments that you know which valve was put in, because they look quite different, and in terms of how you assess the velocities, etc., they behave differently too. So transesophageal or transthoracic, transesophageal echo, 2D, 3D echo, angiography, pre-procedure and during procedure, and multi-slice CT. They're all important modalities when it comes to assessing TAVI patients. MRI, cardiac MRI, probably also important. That'll show up fibrosis on late gadolinium enhancement, and that has prognostic value for some patients. So we divide the assessment of the TAVI patients into the pre-procedure, the procedure itself, and then the assessment after the valve has gone in. And the pre-procedure assessment is mainly transthoracic echocardiography and multi-slice CT and coronary angiography. In some units around the world, probably not that many yet. It might change once the quality of 3D improves. 3D TOE is used to size the aortic annulus, and I'll talk more about that. During the procedure, it's really 90% fluoroscopy and maybe 10% echo, but the echo is very important to look for complications during the procedure and at the end of the procedure, and it's important to assess the result of the valve having been placed, systolic and diastolic function. And finally, in the follow-up, it's really all transthoracic echocardiography. So what sort of things do we look for in the workup on the transthoracic study? Well, first we want to make sure the patients have severe aortic stenosis, obviously. Mostly that's pretty straightforward, but it's not always completely straightforward. We want to look at the morphology of the valve, so we want to know if the valve is bicuspid. Bicuspid valve aortic stenosis used to be a relative contraindication to TAVI procedures. It no longer is, but we do need to know if it's a bicuspid valve, because the results with TAVI for bicuspid valves is not nearly as good as it is for tricuspid valves. It's a much higher incidence of paravalvular leak. So it's important to know whether it's bicuspid or tricuspid. We want to know whether there's aortic regurgitation. Once we do the procedure, and I'll show you an example of an angiographic example of a procedure later on, we want to know whether it's important to know whether there's aortic regurgitation before we start. It may get worse once we balloon the valve before we put in the new aortic valve. The mitral valve needs to be interrogated. Mitral valve regurgitation usually gets better after TAVI if it's present before, but sometimes it gets worse if we interfere with the valve. We want to look at LV function, whether it's segmentally impaired, globally impaired. It can get worse during the TAVI procedure from embolic material going down coronary arteries and so forth. We want to know if there's a pericardial effusion present. We can make that worse during the TAVI procedure, so we need to know what it's like at the beginning of the procedure or before the procedure. Left ventricular hypertrophy is important, especially if it's moderate or severe, because when we place the valve, we usually rapidly pace the patient to make the ventricular stand still. If there's a lot of hypertrophy and we lose capture of the pacemaker, the valve can eject when we're trying to deliver it, and it ends up in the aorta somewhere. And for some of the valves, you can just deploy it there. Sometimes you can recapture it, but you have to pull it around, partly deploy it. That's not the best thing to do. The patient's brain usually suffers if that happens. And finally, left ventricular thrombus is important to exclude because that's a contraindication to the TAVI procedure. Multi-slice CT is used to size the annulus. And the annulus size in terms determines the size of the prosthesis and sometimes the type of the prosthesis we use. We need to know the height between the annulus, the aortic annulus, and the coronary arteries, especially the left main coronary artery, which is usually lower than the right. Because with TAVI, we don't take the old valve out. It sits there, we put the new valve inside the old valve, and we push the leaflet aside. And if the leaflets are long enough or bulky enough, they can occlude the coronary arteries when the TAVI prosthesis goes in. So we need to know the height. Again, that's not easy to measure on toe, even 3D toe, so multi-slice CT is really the way to measure that. We look at the capacity of the sinuses of Valsalva also. You can do that on echo or multi-slice CT. Why is that? Because if you've got, what happens during the procedure is a balance between the capacity of the coronary sinuses to take up the old leaflets, which are pushed to the side, and the size of the coronary of the aortic valve leaflets. If the leaflets are big and bulky and calcified, and you've got very shallow sinuses of Valsalva, there's a mismatch there, and the sinuses cannot take up the space, or have not got the space to take up the leaflets. And finally, we look at femoral access, which is important. Probably 85% of TAVI procedures are performed via the femoral artery. And I should say, I'm sure you all know that TAVI is a percutaneous, a minimally invasive aortic valve replacement. All patients have coronary angiography before we go ahead with the procedure. And if there's proximal coronary artery disease, we treat it usually with angioplasty. If there's mid to distal coronary artery disease, we just leave it alone. And finally, cardiac MRIs I talked about, dobutamine stress echo in certain situations. So firstly, is it severe AS? You all know about the limitations of the flow-dependent parameters for determining whether there's severe AS. If a patient has anemia, moderate AS may become severe AS and so forth. If there are lots of ventricular premature contractions, you want to make sure that the gradient is not accentuated. Atrial fibrillation, aortic regurgitation will increase the gradient. And then there are some special situations. The classical low flow, low gradient, severe aortic stenosis with reduced LV function, where you need a dobutamine stress echo to tell whether it's severe or pseudo-severe aortic stenosis. And paradoxical low flow, low gradient, aortic stenosis with normal left ventricular function, where you usually have a very small ventricle that's very hypertrophied and you've got low stroke volume, which is what gives you the low gradient. And these are just the phenotypes that you might get. On the left is the normal one, where you've got a high gradient and normal flow and either impaired or normal LV function. On the right is the low flow, low gradient, low ejection fraction, where you can have severe aortic stenosis even if the gradient is low, and you need a dobutamine stress echo to tell the difference between severe and pseudo-severe. And in the middle is the hypertrophied, very small ventricle with low stroke volume, low flow, therefore low gradient, but with a small area, with a reduced area, and therefore you can tell there's a reduced area, but normal LV function, it has to be severe. And this is just the flow chart that you use to work out when you have a patient with poor LV function and a low gradient, is it severe, pseudo-severe? You look at the stroke volume. If it goes up significantly, then you have flow reserve, that's on the left. And then you look at what happens to the gradient and the valve area during dobutamine stress. If the area goes up and the gradient stays the same, then you've got pseudo-severe aortic stenosis. But if the gradient goes up and the area remains low, then you've got severe aortic stenosis. On the right side, it's a bit harder, because if you haven't got contractile reserve, then it's very difficult to tell whether you've got severe or pseudo-severe aortic stenosis. It could be just poor cardiac output that's not opening the leaflets properly. Then you go to multi-slice CT and you look at the amount of calcium. If the calcium is extensive, the valve is heavily calcified, then you've probably got true severe aortic stenosis. If not, you treat medically and you've got pseudo-severe. And the group right at the bottom right with true severe aortic stenosis with poor LV function, low gradients, are the ones with the worst prognosis, but they've still been shown to do better with surgery, either surgical aortic valve or TAVI, than with medical treatment. So it is an important group of patients to not miss out on. This just shows sort of extensive calcification on a multi-slice CT, and if you've got that amount of calcification, usually you've got a degree of aortic stenosis at least. So dobutamine stress echo is helpful also. This shows a patient with true severe aortic stenosis, but low flow, low gradient. You can see in the top left-hand panel that the gradient is reduced, but the area is also quite low. And after dobutamine stress echo with 10 mics of dobutamine, on the right bottom hand, the gradient goes up, but the area stays low. That's true severe aortic stenosis with a low ejection fraction and low flow. On the other hand, this one, the gradient doesn't really change, but the area goes up. So when the ventricle starts to contract with the dobutamine, the leaflets open, the gradient comes down or stays the same. This is pseudo-severe aortic stenosis, and you can treat those patients medically. Okay, briefly, what about imaging of the annulus? This is really important. If you get that wrong, something will go wrong during the TAVI procedure. Usually the valve will eject, you'll have paravalvular regurgitation. If you get the sizing wrong and the valve is too big, you might have valvular regurgitation because the leaflets don't open properly, and so forth. So getting the sizing of the aortic annulus, which determines the prosthesis type and size you use, getting that right is really important. TAVI was introduced first in man 2002, and in the first 7 years, 8 years, it was really transthoracic and 2D transesophageal echocardiography by which we measured. That was what we used to measure the diameter, the aortic annulus diameter, and that's how we sized the TAVI procedures. It was subsequently found, when they were looked at retrospectively and compared, these patients also had CT, that transthoracic echo and 2D TOE significantly undersized the annulus, and therefore the valves we put in were too small in most cases. And so we started using multi-slice CT. And why is it better? Well, this is sort of a slide of the aortic annulus up the top left hand, and you can see it's a complex structure. It sort of consists of four rings. The top one is the sinotubular junction, that's the blue one. The red one are the leaflets with the peak attachment near the sinotubular junction and the basal attachment near the green ring at the virtual annulus, and that's what you're trying to measure on echo. And the yellow line is the true anatomical distinction between the aorta and the ventricle. So there are lots of structures, and the annulus you're measuring or trying to measure on echo is not an anatomical structure. It's a virtual, that's why we call it the virtual annulus. And you can see on the right side, in the parasternal long axis view on a transthoracic echo, that this is what you do. You go from trailing edge to leading edge, mid-systole when the diameter is at its greatest. The area of the annulus is bigger during systole than diastole, that's why you measure it then. And you can do this either on transthoracic or 2D TOE. But do you get an accurate measurement of the annulus? And so this slide sort of shows that you don't. Is there a pointer here? That doesn't matter. I can try and use the mouse here. Maybe that'll work. So you can see basically what we've learned from multi-slice CT, more so than echo, is that the annulus is not circular. It's actually oval or elliptical in shape. And so there's a short diameter, which is the sagittal diameter, the AP, and there's a long diameter, which is a coronal diameter. And echo will not measure the right diameter. The white line here is meant to be what you might measure with a transthoracic echo from the middle or the basal attachment of the right coronary leaflet down to the basal attachment of the non-coronary leaflet in the parasternal long axis view. And you can tell that that is nowhere near either the short or the long diameter. And so you get an erroneous measurement of the aortic annulus if you just go on 2D or even 2D transthoracic or 2D toe. 3D has shown to be better, but or has been better, but the resolution is still quite low. So the annulus is oval in shape in nearly all patients, and you need to measure the area, the perimeter, the short, the long diameter, the mean diameter, the perimeter-derived diameter, the area-derived diameter. There are about 6 to 8 different measurements you can use, and various ones work for different valves. This is another slide just of an aorta, and you can see the red arrow is what you would measure typically on transthoracic. You might do slightly better on toe, and in fact, in some toe views, you might measure the longer diameter, and you will overestimate the size of the valve. Again, that's no good. That has its own set of problems. So transthoracic underestimates the diameter of the annulus by 1.7 millimeters, according to one study. Toe, 2D toe, by 1.2. In a more recent study just published, if you look at the bottom right-hand panel, in 48%, up to 48% of cases, the annulus was incorrectly sized on 2D transesophageal echo compared to multi-slice CT. And does it matter? I've sort of talked to you about it already, that it does matter. This is a sizing chart for the Medtronic core valve. And firstly, pay attention to the shape of the valve. You can see how it funnels out at the bottom, which is a bit that sits in the left ventricular outflow tract. Whoops. And next, have a look at the second line from the top. That shows you the range of annulus diameters that works for each of the four different valves. And if you, for instance, look at a 26-millimeter valve, the second one from the left, versus a 29-millimeter valve, you can see if you have an annulus that's 23 millimeters, you could go for one or the other. And so it becomes really important to know that the annulus actually is 23 millimeters, or whether it's a little bit below or a little bit above. And it's certainly important not to undersize significantly. What happens if you get the size wrong? You can rupture the annulus if you put a valve in that's too big. Or if you put one in that's too small and you have to post-dilate, you can then rupture it because the balloon is bigger than it should be. You can get a paravalvular leak if the valve is undersized and there's a lot of calcium in the at the annulus or LVOT. You can get valvular aortic regurgitation if you put a really big valve in and it hasn't got room to expand. The leaflets on the inside of the valve frame then won't work properly. And the prosthesis can embolize into the aorta, which is, or even worse, into the ventricle, which is usually universally fatal. This is just another example, a hypothetical one. The echo on the top measures an annular diameter of 20. The CT one of 20 by 28, so the mean diameter comes out at 24.6. If you went by echo over on the blue scheme, there you would use a 26 millimeter valve. Core valve. If you go on CT, you'd choose a 29. So it really does matter. If you use a 26 and it should be 29, you won't get a very good result. And this can happen. Your valve might end up in the ascending aorta, as is shown on the left here. And you might get paravalvular regurgitation. Does that matter? Yes. If it's moderate or severe, you do significantly worse than if you've just got trivial No paravalvular regurg or mild paravalvular regurg. So it really is important to reduce paravalvular regurgitation. That is much, much more common with TAVI than valvular regurgitation after we put these valves in. So what about 3D? There are papers recently from Rebecca Hahn's group that have shown that 3D transesophageal echocardiography will do just as well as multi-slice CT using similar methods where you do two orthogonal long axis planes and then you work out the short axis, the true short axis from those planes taken from the parasternal long axis views. You will do just as well with 3D TOE as multi-slice CT in terms of sizing the annulus and choosing a valve. What's the advantage of 3D echo? It has temporal resolution, which is clearly superior to multi-slice CT. In multi-slice CT, we just get stills. 3D echo, it will move. It eliminates motion-based artifact. The downside of TOE is that the lateral resolution is not that great. Acoustic artifacts can occur and interfere with your measurements. It's operator dependent, so that if you're not used to doing it, you probably shouldn't do it. Multi-slice CT is really easy to do, and it requires a general anesthetic unless you're really tough, or you know, unless you do TAVIs in Germany where they seem to do TOEs without general anesthetics. What are the advantages of CT? It has better contrast, better resolution, better contrast between the tissues and the lumen, and the operator variability is very low, so it's excellent. So you get somebody who's not used to it, once you teach them how to do it, you mostly get the same results every single time. The downside is you need contrast. So if you've got bad renal dysfunction, there's a limitation of multi-slice CT. Finally, the CT will show us the peripheral circulation, which is great too. Remember, 85-90% of TAVI procedures in most centers, certainly in our center, are performed via the femoral route. It'll show you whether the vessels are tortuous, as you can see on the left. The white bits are calcium. There's plenty of that in these arteries, in those arteries. And then you can get anywhere along the long axis, you can get a short axis, and you can look at the calcium, you can measure the orthogonal diameters to tell whether the sheath you're going to use to deliver the valve with will be accommodated by the arteries. Okay, what about the procedure itself? You do a baseline echo. In our case, we use general anesthetics, so we do TOEs on the day, and you just do a baseline assessment. Then we do the procedure, and during the procedure, you keep an eye out for complications, pericardial effusions, LV dysfunction, worsening mitral valve regurgitation. It should get better. Sometimes it gets worse. And of course, you assess the systolic and diastolic valve function at the end of the procedure. This is pretty much it. TAVI is a sort of team procedure. There are lots of people around. We do it with two cardiologists. The surgeon, sometime during the procedure, will poke his or her head in and just ask how things are going. They're no longer present during the procedure. There are nurses, technicians, echocardiologists, and radiographers. There are lots of people around, and in fact, sometimes it's so noisy you can't really hear what's going on, and you have to ask everyone to be quiet. I'll briefly just take you through the procedure as we do it. So this slide here shows how we gain access. We puncture the left femoral artery if we're going through the right, and then we put a catheter in the top part of the right femoral artery, or right iliac system, and we inject contrast. And you can then see the femoral head here, and we want to puncture just below the top of the femoral head. Below that, we can compress the artery. Above that, we can't. And so we puncture around about here, and you'll see this in the next slide. You can see the needle right here, and we find the artery, we puncture. It works every single time, and it's very effective. We haven't had any problems with that. We then go to the, we cross the valve with a very stiff wire, and we have a pigtail in the non-coronary sinus, and that will outline to us the virtual ring I was talking about before. So we need to see all three leaflets on the aortogram here. We need to see the right in the middle, the left up here on the right, and the non-coronary on the left. And pigtail is in the non-coronary. We know then where the virtual annulus is. We position the aortic valve during the procedure based on this assessment, based on this pigtail position. We have a pacemaker in up here in case we need that. For certain valves, you don't need to pace. For Edwards, you do. For the balloon expandable valves, for the self-expanding valves, you don't need to pace, but you might need to pace if you do a balloon valvuloplasty after. Let's say your valve is underexpanded. You have to expand it a bit more. You need to pace then. Then you need to pace. If your pacer stops working whilst you're performing a post-TAVI balloon valvuloplasty, everything will just eject and it'll end up in the aorta, which is, you know, a small disaster. The procedure we're about to show you used a portico valve, and you'll see that it has a very straight bottom. And when I start showing you the echoes, just bear in mind that it has the LVOT part of the valve is straight. It's not flared like the core valve, and it's quite long, unlike the Edwards valve, which is a relatively short prosthesis. So here we're doing a balloon valvuloplasty. That's why I'm saying we need to know how much aortic regurgitation there is, because after this procedure, after the balloon, it's likely to get slightly worse. It doesn't usually get a lot worse, but a bit is quite common. And you need to have the TAVI valve ready once you do this so that you can put it in straight away should you get severe aortic regurgitation, because the patients do not tolerate that at all well. You do not have to pace anymore during balloon valvuloplasty. We used to think that we had to pace during BAVs, as we call them. You don't have to do that anymore. You can just do it with the ventricle beating. It works very well if you only do one. If you do two, you might have to pace for the second one. So this is the valve across the valve up here. That's the portico valve. It's in its unexpanded form. It's across the annulus. And you can see there's a little bit of aortic regurgitation there, probably because we're holding the leaflets open. In this one here, there's a bit more aortic regurgitation. This is a different patient. You can see if it gets much more than that, the patient might not like it. And this is the delivery of the valve. Basically, we turn a knob on the outside, and the sheath comes back, and the valve opens, as you can see there. It's still attached just at one bit up the top, but so that's what it looks like at the end. And usually straight after that, the gradients are better, hopefully, and there's very little aortic regurgitation if you've done a good job incising the valve and deploying it at the right height. Sometimes, and I'll show you just show you quickly the echo on this particular valve. Whoops. So this is a parasternal transthoracic view of this particular valve that you just saw, and I'll show you how to grade it after, but you can see there are two small jets out here, one at 2 o'clock and one at 5 o'clock, and even if you add those two jets up, they make up a very small proportion of the total circumference, which is how you semi-quantitatively grade the severity of paravalvular aortic regurgitation after TAVI with this particular prosthesis. And so this is trivial, paravalvular aortic regurgitation. I'll show you a different one, which is a little bit more. So this is the second valve we put in 2 or 3 weeks ago. There was quite a bit more aortic regurgitation. A bit hard to tell here. It looks paravalvular, but we really need the echocardiographer to tell us whether it's valvular or paravalvular. As I said, it's nearly always paravalvular. You can see that this prosthesis here is sitting quite deep in the LVOT. And we had problems with the delivery of this one and had to do it a couple of times. This is the parasternal short axis echo after the prosthesis on day 2. And you can tell here that there's quite a bit of aortic regurgitation. It certainly makes up more than 10% of the circumference, maybe 20%. So it's at least moderate. And that's one of the better ways of grading it without spending too much time on it. So what do we do at the end of the procedure? We look at the hemodynamics here in the middle. We measure the gradient. We have a pigtail in the ventricle. We have a pigtail in the aorta. And we look to see whether the gradient has disappeared, as you can see it has here. And we look at the separation between the systemic diastolic pressure and the left ventricular end diastolic pressure. If there's good separation, that usually means the paravalvular or aortic regurgitation is very mild. If there isn't, it means it's more significant, and we really want to know what the echo shows then. We do an aortogram to test for regurgitation, but it's hard to tell if it's valvular or paravalvular. We need you to tell us that. And also, we check the valve position to see how deep it is in the LVOT. And finally, we check coronary perfusion, and then there's echo. We want to know what's happened to the mitral valve. We want to know whether there's a pericardial effusion. We want to know what LV function is like. Today we did a mitral clip, and for about 5 minutes. There must have been some air embolism. That can happen with a TAVI as well. And you got, we saw inferior ST elevation, must have gone straight down the right coronary. It went away, everything was okay. But you know, for a short time there, the blood pressure dropped and we were a bit worried. So that can happen with TAVI too. And probably in TAVI, the patient is a little less forgiving that, than during mitral clip procedures. We obviously want to assess the systolic and diastolic function of the valve as well. So the hemodynamics, this patient has probably got moderate paravalvular aortic regurgitation. You can see it here, and there's another one over here at 9 o'clock. And if you look at the separation, you can see the gradient has disappeared, so the systolic function is great. But the diastolic, the separation of the diastolic pressure and the left ventricular end diastolic pressure was better before we put the valve in than after. It's down to 20, and the magic number is 25. If it's less than 25, and we're not so happy, and we know that there is hemodynamically significant aortic regurgitation. We then need you to tell us whether it's paravalvular or valvular and exactly how severe you think it is. This shows you how it might occur. You can see here that this valve is probably undersized, and you can see there's a gap down here, and there would be quite a moderate paravalvular leak here. There's another one over here. And you can see that the radius of the paravalvular jet might vary depending on exactly what's happening between the prosthesis and the wall of the annulus or the LVOT, wherever it happens. And again, there's a smaller one up here. So this is how it happens. Inadequate or suboptimal expansion of the valve, or the wrong valve size, or too much calcium preventing us from expanding the valve. Sometimes there's non-circular expansion of some of the valves. That happens more with the self-expanding valves than the balloon expandable ones. And here you can see a lot of calcium outside the valve frame. This is the valve here. And you can see that there's a sort of D-shaped expansion, D-shaped expansion of the prosthesis. That might lead to paravalvular regurgitation on the outside, and it might cause suboptimal leaflet function on the inside, leading to valvular regurgitation. So what are the causes? For paravalvular, which as I said is much more common, we positioned it in the wrong position, either too low or too high in the LVOT. We've underexpanded it, or we used a prosthesis that was too small. They're the most common causes. What about valvular, which is significantly less common? We've oversized the prosthesis and there's not enough room for it and the leaflets are not functioning properly, or we've damaged the valve, or we've ballooned the valve after we delivered it and we've overstretched the valve and the leaflets are no longer touching in the middle. They've lost coaptation and therefore you get a small central regurgitant jet. So paravalvular versus valvular, we need to know whether it's valvular as here or paravalvular as on the top panel. The grading of AR is pretty much as how you would normally do it. It doesn't really vary that much. And there's no big difference between surgical valves and TAVI valves. Paravalvular, so, and this is just an example of quantification of valvular aortic regurgitation. You look at the height of the jet in the LVOT, the pressure half time. You might measure the vena contractor. And doing that by 3D color flow is probably a bit more accurate according to some recent studies than just 2D color. And you can also measure the effective regurgitant orifice area by planimetering the vena contractor. And you get a nice assessment. That's pretty straightforward. Paravalvular regurgitation is assessed, as I said, by looking at the circumferential extent of the prosthetic valve paravalvular leak. And we look at less than 10% mild, 10 to 20% moderate, more than 20% severe. I know it's slightly different here, but I think the other classification is the more common one. And then you can look at diastolic flow reversal. That gives you a good idea of the overall aortic regurg severity. There could be valvular and paravalvular regurgitation. You need to know the total AR burden on the patient, and so does the quantitative measurements like regurgitant volume and the effective regurgitant area. These are some of the views and the transesophageal echo that we like. We like obviously the parasternal long axis and short axis to look at the number of jets and the extent of them and exactly where they are. We do the deep transgastic view just to get a good idea of systolic function. You could do the pressure half time there. The vena contractor is not great for paravalvular jets. because there are multiple jets quite often. They're small, they're irregular, they form between the prosthesis and the wall of the LVOT, and there are assumptions of the vena contracta that are not met during this situation. So vena contracta is a bit less accurate for paravalvular jets. Now, this is just shows a short axis paravalvular regurg in the long axis, parasternal long axis, and 3D, where you can look at the, if you get a good look at it, if you can isolate it close to the origin, you can perhaps assess the effective regurgitant orifice area. But the vena contracta is a bit more difficult to know whether that's right or not. Paravalvular leak, you look at the circumference. How often does paravalvular regurgitation occur? Valvular, uncommon. Paravalvular regurgitation, probably 45% have trivial to mild, maybe another 40% have no AR, and up here about 8-9% have moderate, and that's significant. That affects your prognosis, and less than 1-2% have severe, and they tend to die fairly early on. They don't do terribly well. You have a stiff ventricle with poor relaxation, diastolic dysfunction, and suddenly you're volume overloaded, and most of the patients tolerate that very poorly. Okay, what can happen if you place the valve too low? This is an Edwards valve, and you can see that the prosthesis height of the Edwards valve, it's only about 14, 15, 16 millimeters, as opposed to the self-expanding valves, which is 55 millimeters. Here the valve is too low. If you look at this panel here, you can see that the annulus is around here, and most of the valve is in the LVOT. It should be the other way around. We want 2 millimeters below, and we want the rest in the coronary sinuses. So what's happening here is that the native valve leaflet is overhanging the TAVI valve and causing interference with the valve leaflets, and also it's allowing blood to escape through the top part of the frame, into the LVOT, causing quite severe paravalvular regurgitation. The only way you can fix this is to put another valve in, and you place the second valve a bit higher than the first one. And you can see that after that, the paravalvular leak is still there, but it's significantly better. The same can happen with the core valve, which is the self-expanding valve. The stent frame is much, much higher. It's 55 millimeters as opposed to 17. But again, if you place it too low in the LVOT, too low below the annulus, then there is no valve tissue on the inside covering the annulus, and you get free-flowing aortic regurgitation on the side of the prosthesis. And the only way to deal with that is to put a second valve in, starting here and finishing up here. So the second valve goes in a bit higher, and that's a good fix, but you need to put two valves in. Thankfully, you only have to pay for one valve. The valves are quite expensive. For those of you who don't know, the Edwards valves, we're paying $33,000 for one. That's the poorest deal. Some of the other ones are nearly half that. So if you get down to about $15,000 to $18,000 for a valve, then it starts to become cost-effective. If you don't measure the height of the left main coronary artery in particular, you can get occlusion of the left main. As the valve goes in, the left coronary leaflet is pushed up and it covers, in this case, the left main. You need to perform urgent angioplasty, but it's not as easy as it looks on these two frames. And if you don't manage to do it, the patient will go downhill very, very quickly. Pericardial effusions are important. We can perforate with our wires and with the pacing wires. And annular rupture, mainly with the balloon expandable valves, the Edwards valves, a very nasty complication which almost universally has a fatal outcome. You can see here contrast leaking into the mediastinum, and you can see aortic dissection, pericardial effusion, tamponade, the works. So what about TAVI follow-up? And I'll quickly go through a couple of slides and then show you some cases. We do an echo on day one. We do it on the day we do the procedure and the following day. If there are problems, they might have more echoes in hospital, and then they have one at pre-discharge. So they can end up with a lot of transthoracic echoes is how we look at them in follow-up. Then at a month, 6 months, 12 months, and then yearly thereafter, unless something happens, in which case you do it earlier. You look at valve position. It's possible for the valves to migrate even after you put them in. morphology. They can get infective endocarditis. They can have thrombus formation on the valve leaflets. So we need to know about that. That can cause valve dysfunction. You look at systolic, diastolic function, and then all the other things. How is TAVI different from surgical aortic valve replacement? Well, it's different in several ways. There's no sewing ring, for one. So that the areas that you get with TAVI valves compared to the surgical valves are actually bigger, and the gradients are lower. And so the TAVI valves are hemodynamically better than surgical valves. That's the first point. The second point is that if you go to point number three, that the native valve is left inside you. So you've got leaflet tissue, you've got calcium, you've got the old valve still there pushed to the side, and the new valve will interact with all of these things. And it might, as I showed you, not be a circular expansion of the valve. That would affect the gradient and the area, etc. So that's different from a surgical valve where you excise the old valve. So it'll affect the systolic function of the valve. What about the length of the prosthesis, especially with the self-expanding core valve, portico, and there are other ones coming online as well? Well, because of the length being up to 55 millimeters, there's a significant bit of the stent sticking into the LVOT. Once you want to do the valve area by the continuity equation, you want to measure the proximal velocity and LVOT diameter. And you preferably want to do it outside the prosthesis, because inside the prosthesis you get flow acceleration and you will get a faster velocity or higher velocity, and therefore you'll end up overestimating the valve area. And so you want to try and do it outside. That is not always possible. It depends on the type of the valve, and it depends on the depth of implantation. So if we've implanted it very deep into the LVOT, it's very hard for you to go proximal to that and still get a meaningful diameter. In that case, you might have to go inside. It also depends on what valve type. If you got the Edwards valve, it may only stick into the poke into the LVOT maybe 4 millimeters, and you've got plenty of room to measure below that. If you've got a core valve, it flares out, and flow acceleration is probably less than it is with the portico valve, which is straight. So with the straight valve, you'll get more flow acceleration because you've got a smaller diameter of the valve. So all of those things are important. So it's important when you assess the valve at follow-up that you know which valve it was. Wouldn't be bad if you knew how deep it is, although you'll be able to assess that when you do your pictures. And it's also nice to use the same LVOT diameter every single time, although if the valve is deeper, you can't necessarily use the one you used prior to the valve going in. You might have to form a new baseline, and that's what you do on day one. That becomes your new baseline echo. From then on, you should use the same LVOT diameter every time. Otherwise, your area will vary if you use different LVOT diameters, if you measure them differently. Finally, left bundle branch block, especially with self-expanding valves, the core valve, it's up to, let's say, 20%. So you either have a pacemaker, that's due to pacemaker. You can also get left bundle branch block induced without a pacemaker. That causes LV desynchrony. That might make mitral regurg worse, and it might make LV function worse, and it'll affect your assessment of the gradient. So if that happens between before and after, or on day three versus day one, you might get a different assessment. That needs to be taken into account. How do you tell whether there's been a significant change in the valve function? You look at your baseline study, and then you compare it to the subsequent ones, or the subsequent ones to the baseline study. And your day one is the baseline, day one after the TAVI procedure. And what constitutes a significant change? A gradient increase of more than 10, that's the mean gradient, and a decrease in aortic valve area more than 0.3, and a reduction in the Doppler velocity index, which we sometimes look at if there's a discordant results between the gradient and the area, in other words, if they don't make sense. We look at the Doppler velocity index, and a reduction in that of more than 0.1. It's good to have an idea of what sort of area. There are no normal ranges for any of the valves. And so all we have is the follow-up of some of the big registries when we look at valve area and mean gradients. And again, you need to know which valve you're looking at, because they vary from valve type to valve type. So on the left here in the blue panel is a core valve, and you can see that the mean gradient varies here, and this is over a 4 or 5 year period. They followed them up from about 8 to about 10, and that would constitute a good result, no residual LVOT gradient, and a nice result. So if you get something significantly more than that, more than 20 anyway, mean gradient, that's abnormal. Or if there's a change of 10 millimeters of mercury. The valve area seems to vary between, I can't quite see, 1.6 to 1.7. If you compare that to the Edwards valve, you'll see the Edwards valves has slightly higher mean gradients and slightly lower valve areas. And for surgical valves, even slightly lower valve areas and higher mean gradients again. So again, it depends on what valve and what size. And I might just, so we've gone through most of this. So just if you get a discordant result, let's say your gradient is normal, but your valve area is significantly down, that's when you look at the Doppler velocity index and you can use this flowchart. I won't go through it. You can use this flowchart to work out what's going on. It could be prosthesis patient mismatch. It could be you measured it wrongly. It could be because there's a real problem. Okay, these are just the same things as we went through before. Let me show you a couple of cases. This is just to show the LVOT diameter of a patient we did a couple of weeks ago, the patient I showed you the angiogram of. And just to show the measurement of the, this is not LVOT, it's actually the annulus diameter. And you've got to make sure that you can see the right coronary and non-coronary leaflets equally, otherwise you will get a funny diameter. You've got to make sure you measure at the base. I'm not quite sure whether this one here is correct. And again, as I said, the annulus is oval in shape, and this is probably not accurate anyway. This is the first attempt at measuring an LVOT diameter after the valve went in. And you can see the valve prosthesis up here and down here. And I think an attempt has been made at measuring it just proximal to the valve skirt, or perhaps up here we're a bit inside. And it's 1.9 centimeters. And so just pay attention to that number. We then get the proximal velocity. It looks to me like it's probably, it's done in an apical five-chamber view, probably somewhat inside the prosthesis, the stent, which you're not meant to do because you get flow acceleration and you'll overestimate the area. You're meant to do it proximal to the skirt. Then the CW, the gradient is quite low here. We may not have caught it correctly, but you'll see the areas too, which is probably higher than it really is. And that's probably because the velocity that was used proximal to the valve was too high. This is on day two of the procedure. The other was day one. This is day two. And now you can see that an LVOT diameter of 2.1 is used. So they haven't used the same LVOT diameter. This may, in fact, be a more accurate one. It is measured inside the prosthesis. And this is a portico valve, which is straight. So there is flow acceleration. You're meant to measure the velocity at the same area as at the diameter. So there is a potential problem there. In the apical five chamber, two velocities have been measured, one which is clearly proximal, the first one on the left, to the prosthesis, and one which is clearly inside the prosthesis, and therefore the velocity is a lot higher. Which one do you use? The pressure half time has been done, and has been done here, and the valve area, which the day before measured 2.1, is now 1.7. I'm not sure which velocity they used. I can't tell. Perhaps the lower one. And the LVOT was greater, so that should have produced a bigger valve area. So you can see the variables there, quite significant, and you really need to have a baseline study. And from then on, you do really well, and then from then on, you use the same diameter throughout subsequent studies. And that needs to be passed on if the patient has the study done somewhere else. This was the transthoracic study done before of the same patient before we put it in, you could see they had a degree of central or valvular aortic regurgitation, and they had mitral regurgitation, and LV function was not crash hot. I'll then show you the, let me just see what this is. This is LV function straight after we put the valve in, and you can see it's improved quite a lot, and that often happens. If the LV function goes off shortly before you do the TAVI procedure, there's a very good chance that it will improve after you put the valve in. If it's due to myocardial infarction or chronic fibrosis, then probably it won't get any better. The other thing that's worthwhile noticing here is that, and of course that could be due to a number of factors, but maybe the mitral regurgitation is slightly less. Bit hard to tell. You can see here how the prosthesis is really poking right into the LVOT, and that there's separation between the LVOT and diastole and the prosthesis. This is the degree of paravalvular leak in this patient. You could tell in the long axis before that there was a slight paravalvular leak. This is really very minor. When you look at it, you can see two dots here, one at 2 and one at 5 o'clock. It's minor. The paravalvular leak will look worse in the apical 5 chamber because you're aligned with the jet, but even here it looks pretty insignificant. You can see that there are two small jets over here, the two jets we were looking at before. Pressure half time, hard to know what that means when you've got multiple jets, I'm not quite sure. This is day 2, the same patient, interestingly. And now maybe the projection is slightly different, but the paravalvular leak actually looks to me more significant. There's one up here at the top, and there's one further down here at the bottom in the parasternal long axis view. If we go to the short axis, in this particular study, it was difficult to get a good view. You can see there's some interference, maybe some acoustic shattering, etc. You can see one here, and there might be a very tiny one down here. But it doesn't look that significant. The pressure half-time, sorry, let's have a look here. The apical 5 chamber view, there it looks a little more significant, but as I said to you, it often does. And if you just looked at this view, you would probably tend to overestimate the degree of the paravalvular leak. The pressure half-time has reduced a bit compared to the day before. And let me show you one more case, and then we can take some questions. This is a case we did on the same day. This is the toe done on the day, the baseline toe, and you can see there's very severe aortic stenosis, heavy calcification of all leaflets. The next picture, we get a very good view of the LVOT. 2.1 centimeters. There was central aortic regurgitation with a vena contracta 0.5, so moderate. And this is the paravalvular leak after we put the prosthesis in. It looks a little more significant than just mild. There's one up the top, there's one down here. And then remember, the next day when you come back and look at the paravalvular leak in the parasternal long axis view, it will be flipped upside down. So the big jet will be at the lower end near the atrium and vice versa, because you're looking at it from the front instead of from the back. And this is the next day. Let me just see what's happening here. This is just to show LV function is good. You can see that this was a particularly deep implant. We're well into the LVOT. And this is where you can interfere with the anterior mitral leaflets too, if you're too far in. Not so much with this prosthesis because it's straight, but if you got the one that flares, you will impede the anterior leaflet movement if you go past the hinge point, and you might cause acute mitral regurg or gradual mitral regurg because the expansion of the self-expanding valves is progressive. It continues over the days after the procedure. You'll recall that we got an LVOT diameter of 2, and here I think it's measured at 1.5, which I'm not sure what they're measuring here. It's clearly wrong because this is measuring sort of inside the stent prosthesis as opposed to the LVOT. Here's another measurement around the annulus, well inside the prosthesis. This is the proximal velocity, I think in the, actually this is the, this is I think the CW, and the gradient is about 8. And this is the paravalvular leak. So you can see there's quite a significant, remember before it was at the top with the toe, now it's at the bottom because we're looking at it from the other, from the front. And so the leak is on the left atrial side at the back. And you can see there's a moderate, probably you would probably say this is mild to moderate, probably moderate. And there's a smaller one up here. And if you look at it in the, so this has been interrogated really well, this study. The paravalvular leak in the parasternal short axis. Start at the very beginning, and obviously the jet there will be a function of the interaction between the prosthesis and the LV wall and the annulus. And at the very top, it will be quite a narrow space. And so you can see that there's really not much to see at this level. If you scan the valve prosthesis slightly lower down, slightly more further down into the LVOT, you will see things changing quite rapidly. And so now suddenly it looks quite significant. So this I would classify as at least moderate. If you look at it, it's really more than probably 20% or very close to it of the circumference. And so it must be getting close to moderate to severe, but it's probably moderate. And if you go too low, you can see the mitral valve here, the jets start to disintegrate, they flare out in the ventricle, you're past the LVOT. This is not the right place to look at the jets.